What began as a small viral collective has manifested into an established and legitimate music label. The viral popularity and success of 88 Rising has never been seen before in the pop culture landscape. Between their achievements, representation of Asian and immigrants alike, and respect for other cultures, they're more than just a record label. They're a movement, an identity, and a bridge between cultures. This is 88 Rising, the forefront of Asian identity. Between the 1980s and 1990s, hip-hop was the most popular genre, with rappers tackling heavyweight subjects such as financial hardship and gang life, subjects which held interest for young Asian Americans in the 90s as they struggled as children of immigrants, including Sean Miyashiro and Jason Ma, who both grew up around gang-filled neighborhoods, becoming enamored with the music of hip-hop. As much as they admired the culture behind it, they struggled to find Asian American idols in the landscape. Jason would eventually enter the music industry with his love of hip-hop, collaborating with one of the biggest names at the time, MC Hammer, as they ventured into digital distribution long before the creation of Facebook and YouTube. It was here that they realized the potential of Asian media and the digital market. MC Hammer would invest in an independent film called Better Luck Tomorrow, which featured an all-Asian cast and Asian director. This film eventually inspired Jason as he saw an Asian-focused narrative that wasn't bogged down by stereotypes. It was then he determined to one day create a company on Asian and Asian American musical talent. He began by first investing in an Asian American company in 2007 that managed the Far East movement, which created the first Billboard number one song by an Asian American collective, and MC Jin, the first Asian American rapper to be signed to a major record label in the US. Confident in his experience with investing in Asian American musical talents, he then reached out to Sean Miyashiro, who was working at Vice at the time. Together, Jason and Sean would co-found Cash Only, which would eventually become 88 Rising. It started as a music collective and management company, contracting up-and-coming artists found on the internet, including Korean-American rapper Dumbfounded. The same year he was signed, Dumbfounded also showed Sean the music video of Itchy Ma by Keith Ape. Sean immediately began working on getting a remix done of the song, featuring Dumbfounded himself, ASAP Ferg, Father, and Waka Flocka Flame. As the music video of the remix premiered on Complex, it allowed 88 Rising to gain some popularity and traction as a serious record label, recruiting artists such as Joji, Higher Brothers, Rich Brian, August 08, and Nicki. Since then, 88 Rising has released two compilation albums, Head in the Clouds and Head in the Clouds 2, featuring their main lineup and guest artists such as Playboi Carti, Blockboy JB, and Swae Lee. 88 Rising would also present their own festivals in celebration of each album, the Head in the Clouds Music Festivals, which have been dubbed the Asian Coachella. Although Jason no longer works on the day-to-day production of 88 Rising, he's proud of the work of the company and has started venturing into other companies related to Asian and Asian American talents. With the creation of 88 Rising, they've been able to break several records, from their first Asian musician to reach number one on iTunes hip hop chart with Rich Brian's Amen, first Asian musician to top the Billboard R&B / hip hop chart with Joji's album Ballads 1, to Rich Brian and Nicki being the first Indonesians to perform at Coachella. While these records may not seem to be a big deal to some, fans of the Asian actors, artists, and creatives haven't had much to celebrate as a community until then. Sean explains how it was never that there was a lack of talent on behalf of the Asian community out there, but rather that there just wasn't much of a platform for them in the first place. By providing this massive, powerful global platform for Asian artists, they have been able to bring and elevate success to artists who might have otherwise not have been able to reach the same level as they are now. One of the better known examples would be Rich Brian after his breakout song, That Stick. However, a lesser known example is Stephanie Poetry. She released the song, I Love You 3000, inspired by Avengers Endgame. It was very well received, and within a month of it going viral, the song has enamored 30 million plays on YouTube and 28 million streams on Spotify. Her hit song I Love You 3000 was then featured as a remix with Jackson Wang on 88 Rising's second compilation album Head in the Clouds 2. Since then, she has been able to sign onto the record label, becoming the third Indonesian to join behind Rich Brian and Nicki. Landmarks and achievements such as these and the records mentioned before go a long way in the representation of Asians in Western media, and as 88 Rising continues to grow to new heights they've never imagined they would reach before, this message and the core values of the company remains consistent. They are not bogged down by all the business and corporation aspects of their success, mostly in part due to Sean. When asked on how he would know Idiot Rising succeeded, he responds, "I never have to be filthy rich. That's not why we're doing this. It's more about how to contain this purity of the brand. I'd rather die than not continue this. I feel like I'm high all the time, even though I'm sober." Their achievements and core values ultimately become a part of Idiot Rising message of Asian identity, which is what sets them apart from other hip-hop based companies such as Complex or Vice. Fans of Idiot Rising who have been able to look up to their message, proudly identify with, and take ownership of it. Idiot Rising has evolved beyond just a record label or company, they have gone on to become an identity. Idiot Rising has become most prominently known for the representation of Asian Americans in the landscape of pop culture by providing this powerful global platform for artists all across Asia. From Hong Kong, Korea, China, Japan, Indonesia, and more. But that begs the question, why is representation so important? Within recent years, representation has been increasingly becoming a larger topic in the media. Between political tensions and demand for representation, it's vital to understand why it's so important. Representation can affect the public perception of said represented group, especially for those who are not in touch with the represented group. Having improper representation can lead to misjudgment and mistreatment as, intentionally or not, the news and entertainment media have become the ones responsible for teaching or educating what these groups are like and how to treat them. Misrepresentation and lack of can also affect the represented group's views of themselves. In certain cases, it can create a sense of alienation or suppress their sense of belonging, crippling their self-esteem. Having exaggerated or over-the-top portrayal, such as in the case of Asians being A-plus prodigies or martial artists, they can begin to feel as though people view them in such a light. Idiot Rising has been able to change all that up. By showcasing these talented Eastern musicians in the lights of Western media, it challenges their perception of the East. They have been able to do so by providing a great diversity of such between rapping gangsters, melancholic vocalists, pop stars, and so on. By providing such a diverse array of artists, it expands the limited view of the public's perception of these people, rather than to judge their character strictly from the stereotypes conveyed in the media. Sean Miyashiro has also gone on to state that Idiot Rising is not about representing Asian immigrants, but for all immigrants. As Idiot Rising pushes for the representation of their own culture, they have also faced their fair share of cultural appropriation. Hip-hop itself started as a musical medium for black voices to express themselves. As important as the message of Idiot Rising is, Sean still heavily believes that it is just as important to remember where hip-hop came from in the first place, understanding where it is that this culture we have come to love and appreciate came from. For decades, hip-hop has become central to young Americans' understanding of what is cool, and Sean knew that. Increasingly, this was also the case in Asia, but he didn't want to just document the culture of it, he wanted to shape it up as well.
How do you feel about the introduction of like Asian rappers, like Korean rappers, Chinese rappers, Japanese
rappers? Love all that, love all that. That's dope too. I mean, for how long has hip-hop loved, you know, Wu-Tang?
True, very true.
You know what I'm saying? Like, we've loved their culture too. You know, I'm trying to think. Even some of the dress, like even what? I mean, Foxy Nikki's... Brown had an album called China Dog.
Yeah, Nikki just put out Chun-Li, right?
Yeah, like that's all been.
Yeah.
So why not also embrace the people who actually come from that heritage as well?
In the process of doing so, there have been criticism brought up in the past stating that what Idiot Rising is doing is cultural appropriation, stealing from the culture of hip-hop, which has its origin from black culture. Most notably, Rich Brian's breakout song, Dat Stick. With his original name being Rich Chiga, his parody-like approach to gang culture, and his use of the N-word, some people were understandably upset by this song and him. While he has eventually come around to be accepted with the changing of his name and apologies for anyone who had taken offense, initially as a way to combat the controversy, Idiot Rising released a video of well-established rappers reacting to and praising his song as a way to give validation to his name. The video would grow into his own series, showcasing the positive reception and approval of well-established artists, such as the Higher Brothers.
Like this!
They're bringing their culture into it. That's what's important. That's what sticks. That's what makes the shit amazing.
I don't think I've ever wanted to be Chinese more than this moment right now.
I appreciate that my culture and our culture reached so fucking far. All the way around the world, bro. When the sun down here, the sun up there, like.
You know what I like about them too is that they keep it like mad authentic. Like they not acting too hard. They not like trying to be accepted by like hip hop culture or hip hop community or none of that. They just being themselves.
I've never been more proud to be an Asian than now with Idiot Rising, and seemingly so do other people. The influence and impact of Idiot Rising couldn't be more clear. They have been able to break records on behalf of the Asian community, bringing proper representation where there was once a lack of, while simultaneously respecting culture of which hip-hop originated from despite facing previous controversies. Truly, the momentum of 88 Rising has never been seen before in the pop culture landscape. They are a movement, an identity, and a bridge uniting Asian culture and the culture of American hip-hop. This is how you bring representation. This is where the East meets the West. This is 88 Rising.